Good morning. Good to have all of you with us this morning, and I'll remember to welcome those who are joining us on live stream this morning. So good to have all of you with us as we continue on our Lenten journey. Don't forget to pass the pew pads as you think about it, and also remember to sign the cards for our shut-ins on the table by the Sunday school classroom. Last week, we forgot they weren't there. So now you got double the sign. So you're going to get writer's cramp for all the times you're going to sign your name this week. So sign cards for our shut-ins for this week. We continue during Lent on Wednesdays, soup supper at 5:30 with worship at 6:15. This week, Pastor John will be back sharing his part of the story about Peter. And so we will be happy to have Pastor John back with us on Wednesday night. Soup supper is 5:30 and worship at 6:15. If you're thinking about doing flowers for the Easter garden, the deadline is tomorrow, so make sure you get your sheets in for that. In the bulletin, we have the information for Holy Week coming up in 2 weeks, and Easter Sunday as well, so take note of that. And we've got Easter breakfast, so if you want to be a part of that, helping with that, there's a sign-up in the gathering area as well. As we go through our week, we want to keep DJ Eklund in our prayers. DJ had surgery earlier in the week and is home doing well, recuperating, so we will keep him in our prayers and the family as they nurse him along as well. So keep them all in our prayers. Let us take a moment to prepare our hearts and we will begin worship. As you are comfortable, would you please rise? We begin with confession and forgiveness on page 211 in the front of the hymnal, page 211. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin, and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. The opening hymn is number 592.
Thank you. We continue on page 213 in the front of the hymnal, page 213. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Kyrie eleison, Christe eleison,
Christ have mercy.
Kyrie eleison.
Rich in mercy, by the humiliation of your Son, you lifted up this fallen world and rescued us from the hopelessness of death. Lead us into your light, that all our deeds may reflect your love. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated.
God so loved.
reading from the 21st chapter of Numbers. From Mount Hor, the Israelites set out by the way to the Red Sea to go around the land of Edom, but the people became impatient on the way. The people spoke against God and against Moses. Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no food and no water, and we detest this miserable food. Then the Lord sent poisonous serpents among the people, and they bit the people, so that many Israelites died. The people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned by speaking against the Lord and against you. Pray to the Lord to take away the serpents from us." So Moses prayed for the people, and the Lord said to Moses, "Make a poisonous serpent and set it on a pole, and everyone who is bitten shall look at it and live." So Moses made a serpent of bronze and put it upon a pole, and whenever a serpent bit someone, that person would look at the serpent of bronze and live. The word of the Lord.
I'd like to invite the children up front for the children's message. Come on up and join me. Come on up, have a seat. Good to see you all here. Bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, even though we lost an hour of sleep last night. Come on. Oh, we got more coming. Come on, come on. Well, you tried. Maybe she'll watch us from the back. So, I have a question. Anybody have a birthday coming up? When's your birthday? Whoa, yours is like in a couple weeks. When's your birthday coming? July. So you got a little ways to wait. April, that's coming pretty quickly. April, that's coming kind of... The two of you have birthdays like 3 days apart? How do mom and dad handle? And your dad's birthday's in April too. You go broke in April. Yeah. Yeah, okay. Any other birthdays coming up soon? November, that's not soon. Of course, if it was October, you'd say it isn't soon enough. Right, you know, yeah. So I don't know about you, but when I was a kid and it was my birthday, special things happened. Like one thing that happened was my mom would say to me, "What do you want for dinner?" I could choose what we would have for dinner that day. That was kind of cool. And then what would happen after dinner? What's the best part? Cake, right? And ice cream on the cake, right? And what else? Strawberries, ice cream and cake and strawberries. What else? You're missing the best part. What's the best part? Presents, of course, presents. Come on, presents, right? We get presents for our birthday. Does that happen for you guys too? Do your moms and dads too? You know, you get something special to eat. Maybe you get cupcakes. Maybe you get cake. Maybe
yes.
You could say that with more enthusiasm, Trenton.
Yes.
All right, that's better. Good, thank you. So. All those things come to us. Why do we get all those things on our birthday? Why? Yeah, it's a special event. It's a special day. Yeah, that's how many spankings you get, how many years you are. That's not, you know, boy, when you get my age, man, that gets to be pretty rough. Yeah. But there's another reason why we get all that stuff. They love you. Your family loves you, right? Moms and dads and grandmas and grandpas and other people, they love us, and so they want to do these things for us. That's kind of cool, isn't it? I'm going to read a gospel reading in just a few moments, and actually, we kind of got a hint from the choir anthem because it talked about someone who loves us. Who do you suppose that is? God, yeah. And when God loves us, what does God give us? God gives us all sorts of things, right? Love, but the most important is love. And how does God show his love? He gives us it starts with the best letter of the alphabet. Jane, because I'm John. Jesus, right? God gives us Jesus because God loves us so much. God doesn't give us cake and no strawberries. And God does give us the cake and the strawberries, I know. But the big thing is, God gives us his love through ice cream. How about through Jesus? Ice cream's pretty good. You know, it's a pretty good second choice, but I think Jesus is the best choice. God gives us his love through Jesus. I'm going to talk about that in the sermon. So I want you to remember that, you know, that we think about how we get all these wonderful things because people love us, and that is true, but the most important thing we get is the gift of God's love and the gift of Jesus. So thank you very much. You guys can go back to your seats, and as they return to those seats, invite the congregation to stand as you are comfortable and join in the gospel acclamation. The Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus said, just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light and do not come to the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. So earlier this week, as the week began, I started to think ahead to the end of the week and today, and knowing that I'm on for preaching. And I took a look at the lectionary, and lo and behold, I get John 3:16. You know, that is like a preacher's worst nightmare. Well, maybe not quite that bad. But, you know, the problem is with a passage like John 3:16, it is just so familiar. It is so well known. What do you preach about it? It is so well known, the choir's already sang about it. You know, what do you say about something like that? So sometimes the strategy that works is to say, okay, we're going to dive into this text. We're going to dig into the text and really kind of take it apart a little bit and see what's hiding inside. The other strategy is to take a step back and see how that passage, that text, that verse fits in an overall picture and overall flow. And so I kind of had to decide which way to go, and I couldn't make up my mind, so I decided to do both. So we're going to do both. For God so loved the world. And we talked about that with the kids, about love. But I want to take a look at a different word than love. I want to look at the word world. God loved the world. God loved the world. And we think of the world around us and the gifts of life and creation that surround us. Pastor Jean and I are taking a trip this summer along with Rebecca. We're going to go out west. We got a couple of her aunts to visit. One of her aunts is 102, so we want to go see Margie, and then we're going to go out to Washington to see Glendia. And on the way, we're going to be stopping for 2 nights in Grand Teton National Park in Wyoming. I've never been there before, but I'm looking at YouTubes of Grand Teton, and of course, none of them ever show it raining, so I'm assuming it never rains at Grand Teton. It's always bright and sunny We'll see about that. But when I look at the YouTubes and I look at the pictures and the awesomeness of that part of the country, I mean, how awesome, how incredible is that? The gift of creation around us, the gift that God gives, and the world that God loves. Except that's not really what it's about in John 3:16. In the Gospel of John, the world is not the wonder of creation or the presence of all of God's giftedness. The world is that which has rebelled against God, that which has pushed God aside and said, I don't want you in my life. Now, my father was a pastor, and he used to say, talk about sin, and he'd say, what's at the center of sin? And then you get kind of basic, and he'd say, write it out. S-I-N. What's at the center of sin? I am. Me. I am at the center of sin. That when I live in sin, I place myself in the center of the world, in the center of the universe. What I want is more important than what you want, and don't you mess with me. See? Because I am more important. I am what matters. And when I am what matters, I have pushed God aside. And I've said, get lost. I want to be at the center. That's what sin is. Sin is what we are about. We push God aside because we want to be at the center. And yet, John 3:16 asserts that's exactly what God loves. God loves the very beings, the very existence that rejects God. Now, if that seems a little bit odd at all, think about this, moms and dads, grandparents, right? Have you ever heard your kids say to you, I don't need you, I don't want you, I don't want to do what you want me? Do your kids ever do that? Anybody have that problem? No, no, I see some shaking heads here. No, that's good, that's good. We've got a couple saints over here, that's good. And Weston never does that, do you? No, never we do that. Okay, but here's what happens, parents, you know this. What we do as parents is we sort of play this dirty trick on our kids. Our kids say, I don't want you, get lost. And what do we say? But I love you so much, right? That's what God does. God loves the world that rejects him. Isn't that like weird? Except when you think about what it's like to be a parent. That's what we do. But not only is it the world that rejects God, it's us, because we are part of that world. And so John 3:16 begins with an assertion that as we, part of the world, reject God, God refuses, God absolutely refuses to take that for the answer. And so God loves that which does not love God in return, that rejects God. So God so loved the world, and then what? Well, God acts. Love, God's love isn't some kind of a nice warm fuzzy feeling. It's not some emotional trip. God's love is about action. And so God acts to send Jesus into the world, to send Jesus into a broken, messed up, mixed up, upside down, really kind of difficult, hard, challenging world. God acts to send Jesus. And what's particularly significant about that, I think, at least in these moments, is that we live in a world in which we sometimes wonder if God is around. I mean, look at how screwed up things are. Has God forgotten about us? Has God taken a vacation for the last, I don't know, several hundred years or 50 years or whatever it is? Has God given up on us? John 3:16 says, God loves that world so much that God sent his son into the world. Into the world to do something. So right before, the verse right before John 3:15 talks about, just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, that was the reading that Pastor Gene shared with you, just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so the Son of Man, Jesus, will be lifted up. And then later, I think it's in chapter 12, Jesus says, when I am lifted up, I will draw all people to myself. In the midst of a difficult, challenging, messed up, mixed up, turned upside down world, in the midst of a world in which it is sometimes very difficult to see God at work, John 3:16 asserts God is at work. In the person of Jesus, God is at work. And the result of that work? That whoever believes in him may have eternal life. Whoever believes, whoever it is, whoever it might be. Not just the good folk who come to church in a Lutheran church on Time Change Sunday. It is whoever. Not just the people who look like me, who think like me, who agree with me. Not just the people who I like to spend time with. Not just the people who are left-handed, because left-handers are best. Not just people who are blue-eyed, you know, because blue eyes are best. It's all people. Whoever. And in the midst of our context of our world these days, where we have become much more tribal, you know, we kind of gravitate towards the people who in some fashion are kind of like us. We need to hear that again and again, that whoever it is, God welcomes them into this community we call the body of Christ, the people of God, whoever it is. And so we get God loving this, you know, rebellious world, sending into our rebellious world the person of Jesus, who continues to do God's work, who gathers all people to himself. And God makes that promise to whoever, not just the people I like or the people who are like me, but to whoever. So we can take those words and maybe kind of, you know, cling to those or kind of chew on them, ruminate a little bit about them. But there is something else in this passage that maybe makes it a little challenging. Because the text is also very much a text from the Gospel of John. And what I mean by that is the Gospel of John is very black and white. There is light and there is dark. There is black and there is white. There is good and there is evil. There are believers and there are the non-believers. There is condemned and the non-condemned. There is no middle ground in the Gospel of John. And so we read this text and we hear these words, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son that whoever believes in him may not perish but have eternal life. And it's all wonderful stuff, but, you know, sometimes I have to admit, I start to slide back into being more like the world than I really should be. You know, it's that sin thing, you know. I start being rebellious again, you know, sin. And sometimes I have a real hard time seeing where God is at work. I mean, I know God's supposed to be here, but I don't see him very easily. Where is God? I begin to wonder just a little bit. And then, you know, whoever, but sometimes I find myself a little uncomfortable. So what do I do with that? In the midst of a text that makes it, seems to make it kind of clear that I got to be there, got to have it, or else I don't. So maybe what we do is we go to my second technique, and that is to take a little bit of a step back. A little bit of a step back from this passage and see where we are in the context of the text. So we're in chapter 3, verses 14 to 21. Chapter 3 begins with verse 1. That was clever. Begins with verse 1, doesn't it? So in the beginning of chapter 3, a guy named Nicodemus comes to visit Jesus. Nicodemus is a Pharisee. He's a member of the Jewish leadership. And he comes to visit Jesus because he wants to find out about this guy, Jesus. He's heard about him. He's not so sure about him. He needs to learn more. But he comes, it says. We didn't hear this part this morning. You can go back and look in your Bibles if you want at home. But it comes. He comes in the middle of the night. Why do you suppose Nicodemus would come in the middle of the night? Because if he comes in the middle of the night, he can kind of sneak in the back door with nobody seeing him and kind of check out this Jesus guy, and then he can sneak out and, you know, kind of get home through the shadows and not be seen. Because he's not really sure that he wants to be associated with Jesus. So here's what happens. Nicodemus comes in verse 1, and we have this conversation with Jesus. And right about verse 10, Nicodemus says something, and then he disappears. He's not mentioned at all in the story after that. Jesus keeps talking, and Nicodemus just sort of drifts away, I guess. And we don't know what happened to him. We don't know. I mean, did he buy it or not? Until we get to chapter 20. And in chapter 20, Jesus dies on the cross. Maybe it's 19 into 20. Jesus dies on the cross, end of 19. He dies on the cross. 20 is the resurrection scene. So in chapter 19, Jesus is taking his body, he's dead. They take the body off the cross. Nicodemus goes to Pontius Pilate, the Roman governor, and asks for the body of Jesus so that he may give it a proper burial. Nicodemus, who would not be seen in daylight with Jesus in chapter 3, is willing to go to Pilate in chapter 19 and say, I want the body, in the middle of the day. Nicodemus has figured it out. He has finally been able to work that through. Now, that's not the only time that happens in the Gospel of John. In chapter 4, Jesus goes into Samaria with his disciples. They come to a well. The disciples go off to get some food. He's at the well. He's kind of thirsty. It's been a long, hot day. It's noon. And there's a woman there. Now, the woman is a Samaritan. Understand, the Samaritans and Jews do not mix at all. At all. Kind of like Packer and Bears fans. Right? So Jesus is at the well, and he says to the Samaritan woman, you know, can I have a drink of water? And she looks at him, and she says, how is it that you, a Jew, are asking me, a Samaritan, for water? That's how the conversation begins. By the end of the chapter, she's going into town, going to her neighbors and saying, I think I found the Messiah. She's gone from, what do I want with you, to I think he might be the Messiah. Eyes have been opened. Chapter 9, a man who's blind. Jesus heals him of his blindness. And the religious leaders are a little unnerved by this, so they bring the guy in. They say, what happened? He said, I don't know. Some guy put mud on my eyes. I mean, I don't know. Now I can see. I don't know what's going on. And by the end of the chapter, the guy finds Jesus and says, I want to be one of your followers. My point is, we have three stories. Nicodemus, the woman at the well, and the guy in chapter 9, the blind guy. Who takes some time. It takes them some time to figure out what's happening here. It takes them time to realize God loves the world that is rebellious, including me, so much that God sent Jesus into the world, Jesus who is making a difference, even though I can't always see it happening, and that God welcomes all people, even you and even me, into this community of faith. God is patient. One of the messages of the Gospel of John is that God is patient. God is not demanding an immediate answer or else. God is willing to give time as we sort through what we see and how we experience God's work in the world through the person of Jesus. As we begin to see, even in the midst of those moments of darkness, that God is with us. And God is patient and tolerant that there will be moments when I will slide back, because remember, I'm sinful. Or I will begin to look around and say, I don't know, is Jesus really working in the world? I was convinced of it yesterday, today I'm just kind of, you know. God gets it. That's part of our journey. And God is patient with us because God loves us more than anything else. And while God may not deliver birthday cake with ice cream and strawberries, well, actually, God is the giver of that, we know, but you know what I mean. What God does deliver is God's love in Jesus. God's love in Jesus in the midst of our difficult, sometimes very overwhelming journey of life. A good and gracious God delivers love and life. Amen. We continue with singing hymn number 660. As you are comfortable, would you please rise?
Would you please join me as we profess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Trusting in God's promise to reconcile all things, let us pray for the Church, the well-being of creation, and a world in need.
Your mercy. incarnate God, your love enlightens. Open our hearts and minds and those of our living faith partners at Bethany Mauston to fresh understandings of our faith. Deepen our love for you and one for another. Teach us to pray for our enemies. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Loving God, watch over your servants. Be faithful disciples of Jesus. Be with our confirmation students, especially Elena and Jesse, as they seek to grow in their discipleship. And guide their families that together they may reflect your loving grace. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Healing God, your love sustains. Be with DJ and all who are recovering from surgery. Walk with him, grant him strength and patience in the days ahead, and restore him to renewed health and wholeness. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Accompany us on our journey, God of grace, and receive the prayers of our hearts through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us share that peace with one another.
You may be seated. It is Hungry Jar Moment and Mission Moment. The Hungry Jar recipient this month is our summer lunch program. If you're not familiar with that program, there's information about that in the bulletin. So kids will be happy to shake you down if you want to make a gift towards that. Thank you for your support of that ministry. And thanks to the kids for running that stuff up and down. I also want to talk about another one of our missions. As we think about summer lunch and the coming of guys, over here. Don't miss it. As we think about summer, the coming of summer, we think about the great outdoors, and we think about summer camp. The great outdoors, the gathering of the faithful, the grace of Jesus, put it all together, and you get Sugar Creek Bible Camp. Sugar Creek is our Bible camp located near Ferryville. For over 50 years, Sugar Creek has been a place where young and old can retreat from the world to the embrace of a loving God. Then, having been renewed and restored, they can un-retreat and resume their faithful journey as disciples of Jesus. Sugar Creek provides a number of ministries for all ages, with close to 5,000 participants each year. The best-known ministry is the summer camp program, bringing in thousands of kids each summer and making a difference in their lives as they discover community in the shadow of the cross. Our Savior sends kids, almost 25 this past year, to spend a week or a half a week during the summer camping season. And we have also, over the past years, had young people serve as staff at Sugar Creek. Again and again, our kids come back with new learning, renewed faith, and a deeper sense of discipleship. Because that is what many experience, camp ministries are known to be fertile ground for the nurture of future leaders in the church. Pastors, yes, but also, and maybe more importantly, lay leaders, people who live out their faith in their everyday lives. And Sugar Creek is no exception. This is a place where young and old discover God's gifts, but also God's calling to faithful living And that discovery is life-changing. Our Savior supports Sugar Creek financially through our budget, but also with support from our endowment. Welka and Norwegian Dinner have all been places where support has gone to Sugar Creek. We also support the ministry through our participation as we send out our kids every year. And we invite families to take advantage of our camperships. Camp has a cost. It is not cheap, but it is a bargain to other types of summer camps. Our camperships cover up to 40% of the cost and help make camp possible, especially for families with several campers. And that happens because of your support of our work together. So thank you for your financial support of our Saviors, which allows us to be a part of the life-changing work at Sugar Creek. We do make a difference. And thank you for your support of our camperships. And finally, if you want to learn more about Sugar Creek, you can go to their website, sugarcreekbiblecamp.org.
As you are comfortable, would you please rise as we continue with a canticle of thanksgiving on page 219 in the front of the hymnal, page 219. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed our right, our duty, and our joy that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and Merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death in the grave, and by his glorious resurrection, opened to us the way of everlasting life. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Please join me in the prayer our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
For the journey, a feast for hungry hearts. Come. As we partake in communion, we have grape juice in addition to the wine and gluten-free wafers in addition to the regular wafers. If you have needed that when you come forward, please let us know and we will gladly share that with you. For those of you who are guests and visitors, please note the communion invitation in the bulletin. We do sincerely invite you to join with us. As we partake in communion, we sing Lamb of God and hymn number 779. Come, for all is ready. Please be seated.
Oh, God, you bear the sin.
As you are comfortable, would you please rise and would you pray with me? Generous God, at this table we have tasted your immeasurable grace. As grains of wheat are gathered into one bread, now make us one loaf to feed the world. In the name of Jesus, the bread of life. Amen. Beloved, we are God's own people, holy, washed, renewed. God bless you and keep you, shower you with mercy, fill you with courage, and give you peace. Amen. The closing hymn is number 335, 335. Go in peace, share your bread.
Thanks be to God.